John Wesley Harding is the eighth studio album by Dylan, released in 1967. Shrouded by mystery, it tells a tale of utter surrealness in an album made of age-old tunes made to last forever. This is the story of John Wesley Harding, but before we get into that, it requires a little bit of background. 1966, Bob Dylan was at the top of the world, essentially. After reaching the height of fame, he had released the masterful works of Blonde on Blonde and Highway 61 Revisited. He was going on constantly on tour, living an exhausting life of writing and recording music, and not doing one tour after another. When suddenly one day he gets into a nasty motorcycle accident outside of his home in Woodstock, New York. He famously crashed and stopped touring for a long, grueling 8 years until 1974. Dylan had this to say about this crash. When I had that motorcycle accident, I woke up and caught my senses. I realized I was just working for all these leeches. I didn't want to do that. Plus I had a family, and I just wanted to see my kids. In 1966, Dylan essentially withdrew from frantic touring, recording, and appearances and went out into exile for 17 months. It was a chance to slow down, reset, and hide out. According to Dylan historians, the motorcycle accident may have saved his life. It allowed him to slow down before reaching a breaking point. During this time, he took his time to recharge himself and played with his backup band known as The Band in early 1967, producing what would be later released as The Basement Tapes in 1975. By then, in December 1967, he released John Wesley Harding, but it was clear that his music had become more personal and less political as he began his blues and country period, much to the distress of his fans who were expecting music from the likes of Blonde on Blonde or Highway 61 Revisited. Those albums carried complicated masterpieces, folk rock ballads, and epics, but the exile almost brought his music down to its roots again, and all of the songs on John Wesley Harding carry simple instrumental folk arrangements, not something complex or vividly rock and roll. Instead, we are presented with an elementary plain music style. However, it does not detract from the music. A Pop Medical article describing it as having the feel of antiquity settled on it, like decades upon decades of quietly accumulating dust. It is beautifully anachronistic and elusive. It is hard, gritty, and seemingly impenetrable. It is blindingly complex, addictively rewarding. Sounds like Dylan, alright. Everyone had expectations for when Dylan returned to the studio to record music. He was not the same as before the motorcycle accident. He had developed a new persona, someone older, wiser, and bearded, and a reinvention of himself as he had done many times before, showing a willingness to constantly adapt in order to survive. Following Blonde on Blonde, he was always going to be impossible to beat. And so, as a result, John Wesley Harding was always given a bad rap from the start. However, as a hidden gem of unappreciated material of early folk that served as an important bridging album to his later material. The actual historic John Wesley Harding was an Old West outlaw and gunfighter, as the beginning title track of Dylan's album, which added a G to the end of Harding's name.
Wesley Harding was a friend to the poor. He traveled with a gun in every hand. All along this countryside, he opened many a door. But he was never known to hurt an honest man.
The real John Wesley Harding was 15. He killed his first person during the violent period of post-Civil War Reconstruction, claiming it was in self-defense, when in actuality he wrestled a former slave, ran him over with a horse, beat him with a stick, and then finally shot him. He stabbed a classmate in school after a fight over a girl. He was pursued by lawmen most of his life, and when in 1877, at the age of 23, he was sentenced to prison for killing 27 people, although he claimed he killed 42. Really, Dylan, a friend to the poor, never known to hurt an honest man, the person Dylan named his album off was a stone-cold killer. He dramatizes it into a misunderstood folk hero.
It was down in Cheney County, a time they talk about. With his lady by his side, he took a stand. And soon the situation there was all but straightened out. For he was always known to lend a helping hand.
For he was always known to lend a helping hand? Really? After killing the former slave, Harding ran 25 miles away and claimed to have killed 4 Union soldiers who attempted to arrest him. He killed 7 more people on the way to Kansas over a few years. He shot a snoring man through a wall, killed a deputy sheriff, and got a $4,000 bounty on his head. After 6 more years, he was caught and put into jail until 1892, when he was pardoned for his crimes. He was killed in a saloon in 19... 19- in 1895. I think you get the point, though. To say Dylan's portrait of the man is way off is an understatement. Dylan deliberately changed his life story and his lifestyle and delivered it in a three-verse song made of a simple four-chord arrangement. According to the UK archives, the song ends with, "He was never known to make a foolish move," exactly the opposite of the truth. The music is simple, the starline anything but. Dylan didn't unusually give us a clue of what he was up to, saying in 1968, "What I'm trying to do now is not to use too many words. Each line has something." It can almost be examined that this song does not fit with the rest of the album. He misspells Harding's name and also mistells the entire story. Essentially, it makes it look as if the album is going to be a sort of old 19th century American folk tales kind of album. And it subverts our expectations by having the rest of the album have nothing to do with it at all. By mistelling the story, it adds a layer of thought and surrealism to the simple song that otherwise would not have been there. So why did he do this? Did he just want to paint a picture of a misunderstood man that was always there to help people, then let alone name the album that title track? It's quite possible for this is to throw the audience off from the start and then rope them in by changing expectations. Who is John Wesley Harding if not a vicious murderer? Is he us? Is he the individual person that attempts to have a shot at a second chance as the real Harding did once he got out of prison? Maybe not murder, but there's a little bit of that fire in all of us, perhaps. The second title of the track, As I Went Out One Morning, speaks of Tom Paine, the Revolutionary War's author of Common Sense, the book that turned the colonies against Great Britain.
As I went out one morning to breathe the air around Tom Paine's, I spied the fairest damsel that ever did walk in chains. I offered her my hand, she took me by the arm. I knew that very instant she meant to do me harm.
There are so many unanswered questions here to begin with. Why would Dylan reference an outlaw from the Wild West and suddenly go referencing Tom Paine from the 1700s? It's almost as if he's deliberately taking us to the other worlds, historical, abstract or not, and meddling with the meaning of them in order to make us think. Anyways, speaking of breathing air around Tom Paine, as if that is a luxury in itself, showing the importance of his literary work turning the British colonies against Great Britain. The damsel that walked in chains is most likely the Virgin America or America before the Revolution as something desirable, the idea of a new country forming, yet the colonies, or the damsel in this case, still walk in chains, the chains being the allegiance to Great Britain. Yes, as soon as the narrator takes the damsel's hand, you know she's meant to do the narrator harm, almost conflicting the justification of revolution. Tom Paine also had lived in France for a while, or something of the sort, and lived during the French Revolution. In this case, the damsel could be Marianne, the French symbol of the Republic, democracy, freedom, and ultimately liberty. The image remains to this day of a woman wearing a certain kind of cap, first sculpted by a French artist during the time of the Revolution. Yet when it says the narrator takes Marianne's hands and he knew that very instant she meant to do the narrator harm, it could be talking about the endless bloodshed that resulted in the fight for liberty during the Revolution in France. If someone during the French Revolution took liberty into their hands to stand up for what was right, they would have their head cut off. The rest of the song lyrics speak about how the narrator wishes to depart from this damsel representing freedom and liberty in the midst of violent revolution, yet the damsel pleads and begs and says, "I will secretly accept you, and together we'll fly south." And by the third and final verse, Tom Paine came running from across the field, shouting at the girl and telling her to yield. The lyrics read, "I'm sorry, sir. He said to me, I'm sorry for what she's done, hence the beginning of the revolution. He's be sorry for what the fight for liberty has resulted in, which is thousands dead." The third track, I Dreamed I Saw St. Augustine, has a broad context matter of the singer having an enigmatic and subjective interpretation to a dream about St. Augustine and the experience has left him troubled and upset. This is a sad, depressing song. St. Augustine was a real person, but that's what makes this go deeper than what it had before. When Dylan has this dream of St. Augustine, alive as you or me, this is what he says.
Arise, he cried so loud with a voice without restraint. Come out, ye gifted kings and queens, and hear my sad complaint. No martyr is among ye now whom ye can call your own. But go on your way accordingly, but know you're not alone.
St. Augustine was in real life was born in 354 AD and lived till 430 AD. According to Britannica, he was one of the Latin fathers of the church and perhaps the most significant Christian thinker after St. Paul. Augustine's adaptation of classical thought to Christian teaching created a theological system of great power and lasting influence. Basically, he was an important saint that died peacefully and lived a good life. There's a particular view that in the song, St. Augustine is a replacement for Dylan himself, who had been so often viewed as a prophet or messiah anyways. But that might not be true, and so many debate as to why he chose Augustine out of any saint in general. He had to have known St. Augustine had nothing to do with martyrs. He chose that name because it fit the tempo and to, quote, deliberately mix up different sources to paint an interesting and deliberately confusing landscape. By Dylan having this dream of the saint in the song, it shows that the saint had returned to the land of the living to give the final message to his descendants, perhaps saying that there are no martyrs in this generation, and we could keep going on, but they were always going to be watched by the hand of God. It almost insults the current generation of one that doesn't face as much hardship as the people of the past, and when the narrator wakes up from the dream, this is said, "Oh, I awoke in anger, so alone and terrified, I put my fingers up against the glass and bowed my head and cried," just showing how impactful the dream was and how troubled it made the narrator. And that's what the song ends on. Some people believe that not much thought was put into it. It's a fine song. I wouldn't make too much of it of Dylan's theological interest and knowledge, which were probably quite superficial at that time anyway. When writing the song, he evidently thought that St. Augustine had been martyred, which is not correct. He probably didn't know anything specific about St. Augustine and just used him as a convenient symbolic figure for a prophet of doom. Some people, on the other hand, believe that too much thought was put into it, saying that he was talking about sin the whole time, saying he is saying he is guilty of dismissing the saints' ideals without giving them a hearing and is therefore culpable of his death. Because of the glass separation of space, time, and language between himself and St. Augustine and his writings, he cannot become aware of anything beyond the sin of omission. Bowed in my head and cried signifies remorse, and there's nothing more he can do. Whatever the case, I Dreamed I Saw St. Augustine paints a dreamy philosophical question into the album about sin and good and evil. Everyone knows Jimi Hendrix's cover of All Along the Watchtower, but do you know Bob Dylan wrote the original? Let's compare the two and comment which version do you think is better. Unpopular opinion, I know Dylan is a bit of acquired taste, but I personally like his version a bit better, and it's more old-timey and has an old unspoken charm to it that cannot be replicated. Hendrix's cover is obviously much more musically better, with the insane guitar it being generally super badass, but in the end they appear to be two completely different songs.
There must be some way out of here, said the Joker to the thief.
There's too much confusion, I can't get no relief.
Businessmen, they drink my wine, plowmen dig my earth. None of them along the line know what any of it is worth.
Regardless of which version you like better, let's talk about what the actual song is talking about. It's a short song lyric-wise, it's only 130 words, yet it's immensely powerful like a bullet, and it's surprising what Dylan's able to accomplish in such a short time. There's something biblical in nature about it, telling old wives' tales, envisioning destruction in different forms and contexts. The upcoming apocalypse is foreboding and understated. There must be some way out of here, however there is no way out of here. The album is fated, the doom is inevitable. No reason to get excited, the thief economy spoke. There are many here among us who feel that life is but a joke. But you and I, we've been through that, and this is not our fate. So let us talk not falsely now. The hour is getting late. The song continues on its simple journey, and the music remains the same. Same reality, different meaning. However, no matter where you try to escape to, reality always comes back knocking on your door. The song borrows a mythical style in setting up the problem of meaninglessness in our existence. The character of the Joker lacks dignity, and the thief lacks morality. All along the watchtower, princes kept the view, while all the women came and went, barefoot servants too. Outside in the distance, a wildcat did growl, two riders were approaching, the wind began to howl. Some have suggested the last two lines of the song are actually supposed to be the beginning of the song, and it leads into "There must be some way out of here." People say it's Dylan referencing a deal he made from the devil. Some say it's him talking about a class struggle between upper and lower classes, as it does speak of barefoot servants and women coming and going. It could be a philosophical piece about how one finds meaning in a chaotic and very imperfect world. A wild cat did growl, and the wind began to howl, creating a tension and giving us a glimpse of things to come. Two riders approaching suggest a sense of danger or a sense of foreboding on the horizon, perhaps even referencing the four horsemen of the apocalypse. But naturally, the song ends before you can concur what exactly sort of messages they will tell or what chaotic reality they will bring to the scene. Some people say this song is one of the reasons Dylan was able to win the Nobel Prize in Literature. Overall, this song is a masterpiece. It's a description of the land where a seeker of truth must find its own way, wherever the dangers may be. This song, in its three little stanzas, is wonderful in writing and courageous personal philosophy. This is why Dylan was and is still considered one of the culture's great voices. The fifth track is the Ballad of Frankie Lee and Judas Priest. It's a sort of odd tune that tells a story from an outsider's perspective, looking in on these two characters who in the end learn a moral lesson that can be applied to everyone else in the world. This is a long song with many stanzas, so do my best to sum it up for you. The lyrics of the song are a bit happening without explanation, but it is most characterized by logical consequence, possibly alluding to Jesus' temptation by the devil. The story is not very simple. While it is utterly simple musically, in terms of what is being said, there is no simplicity. The song begins with Judas Priest and Frankie Lee being the best of friends, and when they begin a conversation about eternity and paradise and what exactly it means. Judas Priest leaves, and a passing stranger tells Frankie Lee that there's a fellow by the name of Priest calling him down the road, stranded in a house. So Frankie Lee rushes to the house, but Judas Priest says, "It's not a house, it's a home." And suddenly Frankie Lee loses control, becomes entranced as mission bells toll, staring at this house like he's made out of starlight and imagining women's faces in every window, almost allured by the temptation of the devil. Frankie Lee, after all this trouble in the song, dies at the end partly through his own failings, but however mainly because someone else failed to take responsibility for him.
Well, the moral of this story, the moral of this song, is simply that one should never be where one does not belong. So when you see your neighbor carrying something, help him with his load. And don't go mistaking paradise for that home across the road.
According to Tony Atwood on a blog in the UK archives of Untold Dylan, in an interview with Sing Plus Out magazine, Dylan comments he wasn't really ready to produce an album at this time, having nothing of his own that he really wanted to record. However, when called upon to create the album, he spoke of wanting to create songs of despair, faith, and the supernatural. The motto was the Meredith folk song. In other words, he paints a picture of the supernatural in which people are strange, such as Frankie Lee or Judas Priest. These oddly formed and depicted characters that perhaps aren't fully fleshed out for a reason. These out-of-nowhere beings enter our vision, leave us in doubt and wonder, feel like a dream, and then vanish as soon as they arrive. These characters are black, white, and gray. Characters like the Joker and the Thief, like St. Augustine, or Dylan's interpretation of the saint at least, or even John Wesley Harding himself, representing these shadowy, uncertain doubts of the human experience. Morals of the story are expressed in simplistic notions. Do not risk moral death if you don't take responsibility for yourself, as Frankie Lee died for going in a place he did, quote, not belong. The second moral is to help your neighbor when he's carrying a heavy load, or a sort of cliche lesson that the narrator naively speaks of, just as he naively speaks that Judas Priest and Frankie Lee are the best of friends, when the content of the song speaks otherwise to this deluded conclusion. The song ends with Don't Go Mistaking Paradise, with a home across the road, which sort of grounds the listener who is directly addressed here, not to go making the same sort of mistake that these black and white characters have made, almost as if they just exited a dream. It can be seen as a don't attempt to appease the temptations of sin sort of message, although the song isn't very religious and it could only be interpreted this way through a certain lens. Human weakness is represented by Frankie Lee, who has succumbed to the pressures of life and risky business, and moral demise is represented by Judas Priest, who refused to help his neighbor with his load, or in other words, be responsible for Frankie Lee. Through this song, we can better understand the shortcomings of the human experience and what we can do to improve our lives for the better. The sixth track in John Wesley Harding is Drifter's Escape, where in this song we meet the Drifter, another character that is dispossessed and broken down and mysterious in their ways. But the music again is so simple, just two rotating chords and two short lines of melody alternating. But it somehow works paired with undeniably beautiful poetry that's absolutely stunning and allows us to picture the scene and fully comprehend what the Drifter is feeling. There's a lack of control over his life. We can feel his desperation through the wailing and winding chords and the twinge exasperated in Dylan's voice. The story goes like this. This outsider is oppressed by society yet not defeated, as the protagonist, or the Drifter, is put on trial without knowing what the charges against him are. My trip hasn't been a pleasant one, and my time isn't long, but I still don't know what it was I've done wrong. the judges on the drifter's side and is sympathetic to his cause, as the drifter didn't do anything wrong. He is just disliked only because he is dirty, a traveler, ignorant, illiterate, uneducated, the wrong race with the wrong accent, any or all of those. The jury are the ones with the real power to convict, and the judge's power was to stop the conviction of an innocent man oppressed by the system. It's a song about mob mentality almost, because what the many say is more powerful than what the correct or morally sufficient say. When suddenly out of nowhere, just then a bolt of lightning struck the courthouse out of shape, and when everyone knelt to pray, the drifter did escape. In other words, the innocent drifter put on trial is able to escape through divine intervention or some sort of miracle bolt of lightning that destroys the courthouse and a freak accident that just happens to play in the protagonist's favor. The jury, or the mob, turns out to be the guilty party in the supposedly just court system. According to Wikipedia, some commentators have pointed to parallels between the song's story and Dylan's own experiences at the time, around the time he wrote the song. The drifter does not understand the charges against him, just as Dylan did not understand the criticism he received from moving from folk to rock music. The jury cried for more, just as Dylan's fans who followed his path to rock music became more oppressive, as the lightning bolt that allows the drifter to escape could be a metaphor for the motorcycle accident Dylan suffered in 1966. So in a lot of ways, the same way the motorcycle accident saved Dylan, the bolt of lightning saved the drifter. Or the other way around, but you get what I mean. The next three songs have to do with the poor, the dispossessed, the poverty-stricken, the dirty hobo characters that Dylan sympathizes with. First, we have Dear Landlord, which adds balance to the album as Dylan sits down the guitar and harmonica to play piano in a somber tune, a ballad that depicts the narrator pleading with their landlord while uncovering a broader existential rumination.
Dear Landlord, please don't put a price on my soul. My burden is heavy, my dreams are beyond control.
Dear Landlord, please heed these words that I speak. I know you suffered so much, but in this you are not so unique. I particularly enjoy these lines. All of us at times we might work too hard to have it too fast and too much, and anyone can fill his life up with things he can see but just cannot touch. But like, what does that last part mean? With things he can see but just not touch. He really delves into the mystical aspect of double-sided meanings and whatnot. Anyways, with the poor narrator pleading to the landlord to show mercy, it adorns the same sort of pattern we've seen throughout the rest of the album. Personal afflictions with characters like a hobo, an immigrant, a wicked messenger, and a drifter, some of which we'll get to in a moment. The beginning line of Dear Landlord, Please Don't Put a Price on My Soul really solidifies and leads the rest of the song as a line that merges around which a partial commentary or story is woven. However, there is no coherent structure or theme to base off of, so the final product comes off a bit like an abstract painting. There's a recognizable character in there, a relatable one even, a man who trying to pay his rent, but for some reason he exists within a mist. The desires, intentions, identity, even appearance is never completely endowed or revealed to the audience, and that's what part of makes it so invigoratingly genius. Dylan did not play this again ever until 1992, about 25 years later, showing that he himself probably did not know what it was all about. Next two songs, I'm a Lonesome Hobo and I Pity the Poor Immigrant, speak well of a lonesome hobo and a poor immigrant, which Jim and Dylan sympathizes with. The hobo has served time for everything except begging on the street. He speaks about how he's once rather prosperous but threw it away by being arrogant and trusting the wrong people. Then he tells the audience to stay free from petty jealousies, live by man no man's code, and hold your judgment for yourself lest you wind up on this road. Pretty straightforward, he was thinking about what brought him to this low state and warning the audience not to do the same. Out of the two songs, I like I Pity the Poor Immigrant better, probably because it's so mournfully sad and the slow nature of the song almost puts me to sleep. This piece has attracted a few commentaries, but the trying to decipher the actual meaning is a bit like a rabbit hole. There's a sense of idealizing life on the road, and the term immigrant is actually loosely used to be a possible metaphor for an outsider that does not respect or integrate himself into his new home. The line, the immigrant who passionately hates his life and likewise fears his death, is a sort of double-sided coin whose imagery doesn't exactly coincide with what you would think when you hear the word immigrant. It's a curious mix of horribly mournful, deadly serious, and ironically comedic. This immigrant character, sort of like Frankie Lee, is searching for paradise, his promised safe haven, and he's expecting that by immigrating, it will land at his feet with a start, and instead he is faced with the cold hard reality that is not how the world works. Dylan is focused on people who think that the answer to all problems is simple, as this such as, only if I moved to another country everything would be alright, if only we had more money, if only she loved me, then everything would be alright. The moral of the story is that a simple change is never the solution, it's always more complicated than that, and so yes, he pities the poor immigrant. The Wicked Messenger, a short 2-minute long song I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about, is basically just religious poetry. There was a wicked messenger from Eli he did come, Dylan sings. Eli is a variant on the name of God as spoken in Hebrew or Aramaic, and he may also refer to the high priest of Shiloh. Either way, Eli is a representative of God, and this suggests that the messenger is not actually wicked, even though the narrator says he is, and so the narrator comes off as deceitful and misrepresentative of what the messenger actually says. Going off of David Weir's interpretation, which I highly suggest you guys read for all of these songs, it's online, the messenger remarks that it feels like the soles of his feet are burning, suggesting that the place in which he is delivering his message is full of evil or has hellish qualities to it. The third verse depicts the sea being parted and leaves falling. Leaves falling references falling angels or the consequences of the messenger's warning from God not being heeded. The narrator reports that the messenger was confronted. Keep in mind, this is a messenger from God, someone that should be welcomed, not confronted. The bitter truth he leaves us ends the song with, "If you cannot bring any good news, don't bring any." It's also contrasted with the fact that this piece of music is relatively jolly and bouncy and upbeat compared to, say, Shifter's Escape or I Pity the Poor Immigrant, almost making a comedy out of the messenger from God's warning about what not to do, taking jabs and hints at a possible coming apocalypse in a prophetic sort of way that is reminiscent of All Along the Watchtower. The last two songs on the album are love songs. They were written after all the rest and don't match the mood of the rest of the album, full of odd characters and misty great apocalyptic prophecies, but it is somehow fitting to end the album on a note about love. The first song, Down Along the Cove, is a simple 2-minute tune with Dylan on piano, another dude on guitar, and you can tell they're having fun jamming out, but that's not the most crazy mind-changing thrillers thing. He ends the album with I'll Be Your Baby Tonight, and it is a simple, sweet, sentimental love song. They both stand on the side of simple romance.
Shut the shade, you don't have to be afraid. I'll be your baby tonight.
It doesn't exactly convey that anything is amiss or wrong, such as the sad or anger, confused love songs of Blonde on Blonde. Instead, presents a clear picture of love as one that's a feeling you can grasp, a good, positive feeling, something that you can understand and soothe your lover with. In conclusion, this album is full of stories ranging from biographical to biblical, yet they are similar in their own vague nature. The first new material of the singer in more than 18 months, appearing without any publicity. No sitters on this album, no screeching guitar solos, no just 12 short acoustic songs with pared-down lyrics. Another interesting thing about the songs on this album is that if you look at the chronologically of when the songs are created, they're created pretty quickly, most of them containing three verses and a chorus. This exemplifies the notion that Dylan was simply writing the songs because he had to create an album. He wrote the lyrics in the same format and set about adding music to each one. Some might say this degrades the music, but it doesn't make it any less a worthy set of tunes. All these songs have been able to entertain many for decades, showing the timeless appeal and Dylan's ability to write excellent material, even if it was in a short period of time. However, after writing Down Along the Cove and I'll Be Your Baby Tonight, he simply stopped composing. After 6 years of non-stop composing, in which he wrote hundreds upon hundreds of songs, he just stopped. In 1968, he wrote Way, Lady, Way. In 1969, he created Nashville Skyline, where the album is only 26-something minutes long, and none of those songs are thought to be his better work. This creates the picture that John Wesley Harding was his last push of creative drive he had in him. Dylan returns from his exile in this album to create a quiet, country-tinged track list that splits dramatically from his previous work in a constant effort to reinvent himself. It's not even a return to his roots of folk, instead it's his first venture into country. It almost actually stands out compared to his other albums with strong themes of moralism, religion, whether it's not to a preachy level like on Soul Train Coming, instead it's narrative-based. Simple songs reveal layers of meaning upon subsequent re-listens, and although the lyrics are somewhat purposeful and complex, the music is anything but. It's simple, melodic, and direct. Compared to Blonde on Blonde, which is so personal, this feels rather distant from Dylan, as if he was figuring out things in his life, which is something that humans do. Songs that come from a strange place in Dylan's life are sort of in-between crossroads. This album is often given a bad rap, but in all reality is a hidden gem of underrated and underappreciated material. Each song is something meaningful to offer, and even though the album was put together quickly, it never feels rushed or underproduced. Instead, it feels vibrantly dense and musically hauntingly beautiful. The album tricks us by having the opening and title track be about a Wild West outlaw, and it completely subverts our expectations and gives us the trip of a lifetime across dusty old tales and moral lessons that are hard to quantify or even decipher. And it may be an acquired taste, and it may take a while to appreciate, but John Wesley Harding is a hidden gem, and I highly recommend you listen to it. That's about it. Let me know if you'd like more of this content in the future. Make sure to smash that like button and subscribe.
Take risks around the cook up list. Just wanna be like Mom and Tucker. I'm gonna take a name real quick.